Well, welcome to part number 5 of our Radical Teachings of Jesus series. How many of you have come to at least one of the other meetings that we've been having? Great. Have you been blessed? Have you learned something so far? Yeah, I think we've been having a pretty good time fellowshipping, eating some good food, and then gathering together for these teachings, these radical teachings that Jesus taught during his ministry on earth. And we've found that it wasn't just radical back then, 2,000 years ago. These teachings are still radical for us today in 2016. Some of the things that we've covered already in our series is the first night we looked at the identity of Jesus. What Jesus taught about himself was radical because he taught that he was the Son of God. He taught that he came from heaven to this earth. He taught that if you had seen him, you had seen the Father. And that he wasn't just a good teacher or a good moral teacher, but this is that he was actually the Son of God. He also taught about the scriptures, that the scriptures are a valid, foundational thing to put our faith in, that people have come along and try to discredit them or try to only think that they have some good teachings and everything else that doesn't make sense rationally isn't important. But Jesus, he placed his faith in the scriptures because he said they weren't just the ramblings of some people that went into a cave somewhere and made up their own ideas, that the scriptures are actually the literal word of God. We looked at the salvation of Jesus, that to be saved, to have eternal life, all we have to do is look in faith to the cross of Christ. I mean, that doesn't make too much sense to us how that can be, how that works. But Jesus says it's an act of faith. You just have to believe that I died for you. And when you believe that, when you look to my death in faith, you will have salvation. Then last night we looked at the Sabbath and what Jesus taught about the Sabbath, that the Sabbath was a beautiful gift that God gave to us, and that the seventh-day Sabbath was something that God intended for us to enjoy at creation. It was the seventh-day Sabbath that God wrote in the Ten Commandments, and it was the seventh-day Sabbath that Jesus kept and that he encouraged and taught his followers to keep. And he says, remember it. Don't forget to about the seventh-day Sabbath to rest and to find that day of blessing and healing. Don't forget to bless others on the seventh-day Sabbath. Remember the seventh-day Sabbath to keep it holy. And today we're looking at the atonement of Jesus. The atonement is one of those kind of fancy theological words that sometimes might be a little confusing, but what's good about this word is you can see the meaning of it right in the word itself. Atonement means at-one-ment. Atonement is the process or the act of being brought back together, at being at one with God, being reunited. So today, we're looking at this radical teaching of Jesus, talking about the atonement. A few years ago, there was a 12-year-old boy that had to go to court. And he stood there before the judge, being this tall, the judge sitting perched rather high on that wooden bench, and the boy was just afraid. You know, he was his knees were knocking together. He was shaking in his shoes. He started to sweat a little bit, and in fact, the boy had done nothing wrong. He was actually there in the court that day because his bike had been stolen out of the parking lot of the local library, and he had to appear in front of the court, in front of the judge, to present his case and to as part of the court case. But he was still so scared. It was intimidating for a boy to be in front of a judge that had so much authority and so much power. You know, he said it looked like the judge was an eagle perched, just ready to swoop down and snatch him up. And the judge, of course, had his trusty wooden gavel next to him, you know, to render the verdicts or to call for order in the court or all those kind of cool things that gavels help judges do. But while the gavel looked like this, fairly normal, to the boy that was shaking in his boots with fear, the gavel looked like that. He said, the gavel, man, the judge is going to smash me over the head with this gavel. This is crazy. Get me out of here. It's interesting that many people view the final judgment in the same way that this little boy viewed that judge. A lot of Christians even have this concept when it comes to the final judgment of something that's to be afraid of, something that strikes terror and fear and anxiety and worry into our hearts. But is that really what the judgment is about? See, we have read verses like this, like from Revelation chapter 14, verse 7, which says, "Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come." We also read solemn warnings that Paul gave, for example, to the Christians in the church in Corinth. He says, "We must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one of us may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad." Now that doesn't sound too encouraging, does it? I mean, if we just focus on these kind of stern and solemn and fearful images or warnings, we can come across or come away from the Bible thinking that, yes, the judgment, that's something to be afraid of. It's something that causes a lot of us stress and anxiety. So today we're going to look at what Jesus actually taught about the judgment. And in fact, I think many of us are going to be surprised to find that the judgment is actually good news. The judgment is nothing to be afraid of. The judgment is good news because it is through the judgment that we have atonement. It is because of this judgment, of this final judgment, that we will be brought back together at one with God. So let's see what Jesus taught about the judgment. One of the things he taught about the judgment was that it's a real event, that it's actually going to happen. He says in Matthew chapter 11, verse 21, he says, "Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes." He continues and he says, "But I say to you, it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon on the day of judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, who are exalted to heaven, will be brought down to Hades. For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Sodom, it would have remained until this day." And Sodom, these other cities you might not have heard of, Tyre and Sidon, but Sodom has been that name of a city that's been associated with wickedness and evilness for centuries, for millennia. But Jesus is saying, Sodom is going to face judgment on that day, but it's going to be easier for them because they hadn't had the grace and the mercy. They hadn't had the prophets come to them. They hadn't had me, God, in human flesh come to them and try to get them to turn their way. So judgment is going to happen, and it's going to be a tough thing to experience for people that lived in these cities, for people in general. Judgment, there is a judgment day. It's coming. And it is going to be something serious. He finishes by saying, "But I say to you that it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for you." Jesus also says in Matthew chapter 12, "For every idle word men and women may speak, they will give account of it on the day of judgment." There is a day of judgment coming, and Jesus is very, very clear that this day of judgment is going to happen. So you questioning here, "But Pastor, I thought you said this was good news." That doesn't sound like very good news to me. I've said some idle words in my life. I've said some things that I'm not so proud of. Yeah, maybe I don't cuss like a sailor, but maybe I've said a few lies. Maybe I've gossiped some. And now Jesus saying I have to give account for all my words on the judgment day, that there is going to be this serious judgment day, that doesn't really sound like good news. Well, listen to what else Jesus has to say about this judgment. He says, "For the Father judges no one, but has committed all judgment to the Son." How many people does the Father, does God the Father judge? How many? No one. So if God the Father isn't doing the judging, who is? The Son. Jesus is doing the judging. Jesus is the judge. I mean, this kind of changes things, right? Because God the Father, which unfortunately many people have this image of him that as this kind of stern guy with a long gray beard that's just waiting to zap people with lightning bolts, you know, that we talked about this at the identity of Jesus and who he said he was. You know, he said, you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So even though that's not really what God the Father is like, that's still the mental image that many people have of God. And so they think, oh, he's going to be the judge and he's just going to be zapping people right and left. But Jesus says, no, even though you don't quite understand who the Father is, you don't even have to worry about that because he's not even the judge. I'm going to be doing the judging. Me, your friend. The person that you see, the person that you talk to, the person that you've seen perform miracles of healing, the person that you've seen and heard forgive sins and change lives and extend mercy and forgiveness and grace, I'm the one that's going to be doing the judging. And this is good news. In fact, this is good news part one. There's going to be three parts to the good news and the judgment this morning. Good news part one is this, that Jesus himself is the judge. Jesus is the judge. Now, think back to that 12-year-old boy in front of the judge, being scared out of his mind almost. Imagine if he had looked up at the judge and saw that he actually knew who the judge was. Imagine if he had seen one of his friends there serving as the judge. And the judge looked at him and gave him a smile, a wink, and maybe a thumbs up, a sign of encouragement. Do you think that would have changed the boy's perception of the judge? Of course it would have. And this is what Jesus is saying. He says, look, I'm going to be doing the judging, and you know who I am. You know what I'm about. You're my friend, and I'm going to be judging your case. When the Son of Man, again, one of Jesus' titles he gives to himself, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. We're going to learn about the second part of the good news through this story that Jesus tells in Matthew 25. It says, all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another. This is the judgment day. The Son of Man, he has come on his throne in glory, and everyone gathers before him to be judged. And as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats, and he will set the sheep on his right, and the goats on the left. Then Jesus will say to those on his right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? And the king will answer and say to them, assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. Then he will also say to those on his left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. See, the judgment isn't all rainbows and lollipops. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not take me in. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not minister to you? Then he will answer them, saying, assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did not do it to the one of least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The judgment is happening. But we have to be careful not to read too much into this story, because this story isn't a description of how we are to be saved. We covered this in a tremendous amount of detail a few nights ago when we looked at the salvation of Jesus and how he was super crystal clear that the only way to be saved was by looking at faith to his sacrifice on the cross. So this story here isn't a description of how we can be saved. It's describing the result of people who have been saved, their response to the salvation event. Like the story we looked at that night of Zacchaeus. It was because he received Jesus joyfully that he went out and gave away half his wealth to the poor and that he repaid anyone that he had cheated fourfold. It was because he had already received Jesus. It was because he was already had received that gift of salvation that he responded in those amazing ways. And this is what the story describes. It describes people that had looked in faith to Jesus on the cross and had received him joyfully. And because of that salvation that they had received, that they went out and they ministered and they did these amazing things that fed the hungry and clothed the naked and visited the people in the hospital and in prison. They did these things because they had already looked to Jesus in faith. That's what the story is saying. But the point of this story is the very clear fact that Jesus is going to separate people here at the end, at the final judgment, but he's going to know for sure who belongs to him. That's the point of the story, is that he recognizes who is who. He recognizes the people that have looked to him in faith and responded appropriately, and he recognizes those who hadn't. He recognizes those who are genuine in their faith as they believed in Jesus. And he recognizes those that might have talked a big game, but really hadn't truly believed and placed their faith in him. He realizes and he knows and he recognizes who belongs to him and who doesn't. This is what the story is saying. Now imagine again that little boy in the courtroom. Imagine if the judge had gone to render his verdict and he actually made a mistake and found that the actual boy was the guilty party, and he had the bailiff come and haul the 12-year-old boy off to jail and not the bicycle thief. That would have been horrible, right? That would be a travesty. But the judge didn't, because he knew who was who. He knew who the innocent party was, and he knew who the guilty party was. In the same way, God knows who is who. Jesus is going to be able to tell who belongs to him and who doesn't. Let's say I brought a pack of 100 dogs up on the stage here with me. Now, I'm not going to, because that's it'll be a little bit of a circus, or a big circus, and I don't have any dogs in the back room here. But just imagine I brought a pack of 100 dogs out here on the platform. Now, how many of you have a dog as a pet, or have ever had a dog as a pet? Yeah, most hands up. So out of this pack of 100 dogs that are up here, would you be able to identify your dog if it was in this pack? How would you be able to do that? I mean, there's 100 dogs up here. You'd be able to identify your dog because you know who your dog is. You know what your dog looks like. You know your dog. Even though there might be a huge pack, you know your dog. And if you were to call your dog, they would respond, right? I mean, if they weren't too wild, you know, in the pack of 99 other dogs, they would respond to your voice because they know who you are as well. Do you see the point here? Jesus knows who belongs to him. Jesus knows who really is his follower, who really has placed faith in him, who really has that connection, that relationship with him. And he knows those that don't. Good news number one was that Jesus himself is the judge, our friend, our Savior, he is the judge. And good news number two is that Jesus will identify those who belong to him. And that's good news because Jesus knows. He's not going to get confused. He's not going to make any mistakes. He's not going to miss out and get, we're not going to get lost in the crowd, because he knows who is who. He knows if we belong to him or not. And that's good news. Because, and I'm happy that Jesus is going to be the judge, Because, frankly, not to offend any of you, I'm glad that you're not going to be the judge. All right? And I'm sure you're glad I'm not going to be the judge. Because, as people, we do a really horrible job at identifying who belongs to Jesus and who doesn't. Because as people, we look on the outside, right? We only view people's exterior appearance. But God, Jesus, looks at the heart. He knows what the person is, who the person is. He knows who belongs to him and who doesn't. And that is why I am thankful that Jesus is the judge who will be doing the identifying on that final judgment day. The third piece of good news is probably the most radical teaching when it comes to the judgment. We find this in John chapter 5. Jesus says, "Most assuredly I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life." And this is great news. This is the radical news. This is the tremendous, amazing news that we've talked about, because this is the news of salvation. That Jesus says, believe in me, put your faith in me, and you will have eternal life. But the radical part of this teaching on judgment is that Jesus doesn't stop there. The verse continues, the sentence continues, and Jesus finishes by saying, "And you shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life." See, Jesus is saying, when you look at me in faith, when you believe my word and you believe in the one who sent me, you don't even have to worry about the judgment, because you're not going to have to face it. You will have already passed from death into life. And this is an amazing teaching. This is a radical teaching, because so many times we get confused. We don't understand the fact that all it takes is for us to have that belief in faith in Christ and his crucifixion, and we will have passed from death into life. But he says, believe in my word. And so what is that word that he calls us to believe in? Well, he says in John chapter 6, Jesus says, "Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life." See, the word that we're called to believe in isn't a word. It's not even a combination of words. There's no magical formula to get us eternal life. The word that Jesus calls us to believe in is him. It's not a word, it's a who. He is that word. See, we see this in John chapter 1. John, the disciple of Jesus, he writes in his gospel that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. This is what Jesus is saying, that I am the Word in flesh. And he calls us to believe in that Word. He calls us to believe in him. And he says, if you believe in me, and you believe in the one who sent me, and you believe in the Father, if you believe, if you look in faith to the cross, then you will have salvation. Salvation is yours, and not just salvation, but this assurance, this knowledge, this confidence that we have passed from death into life, and that this judgment is nothing to worry about. For the Father judges no one, but has committed all judgment to the Son. Jesus is that judge that we're to face on that final judgment day. Most assuredly, I say to you, this is certain truth, he says, he who hears my word, he who hears me and believes in God who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment. On that judgment day, there's nothing to be worried about. There's nothing to be stressed about because you have passed already from death into life. And that is good news number three. That for those who belong to Jesus, the outcome of the judgment is already settled. Listen to me clearly. That when you belong to Jesus, when you have connected yourself with Jesus, when you have looked in faith to the cross of Christ, that you don't have to worry about the judgment anymore because it is settled. As we say, it's a done deal. When you belong to Him, He knows it. And on that judgment day, there's no need for worry. There's no need for stress. There's no need for anxiety because that judgment has been settled already in your favor. Do you remember a time when you had to take a difficult test? Yeah? A few of you at least? I remember several difficult tests I had to take in school. Now, there was once a boy that had moved, and he was dropped into a new school, and they put him into a physics class. And he had never taken physics before. He really didn't know what was going on. He thought the teacher was speaking a different language. Any of you had a class like that? Yeah? For me, it wasn't physics. It was biology. I was like, what is this guy talking about? I have no idea. Why are we spending 3 weeks dissecting carrots? What's going on? But he gets to physics, and it's just difficult, and he tries, but he just can never get his mind wrapped around it. And at the end of the year, he has to take the final exam, and the final exam, he scores a 37%. Not a passing grade at all. Have you ever had a test? Maybe you didn't score quite a 37% on, but you scored a grade that you weren't really wanting or hoping for or expecting. Now imagine that before the test began, a week before the test began, imagine the teacher came up to you and said, you know, we have a very important test in a week, but I have some good news and I have some bad news. It's an extremely difficult test. In fact, that the test is so difficult that only one person has ever passed it. That would be the bad news, right? Sad face emoji. But the good news, the teacher says, that one person who passed it was me. And in fact, I passed it when I took it on your behalf. And you scored an A+. Now that's the good news. Smiley emoji. Right? That would be tremendous news to know that the test, the difficult, the nearly impossible test, you don't have to take it because it's been taken and it's been passed in your name. This is what the judgment is. This is the good news of the judgment. That the judgment is nothing to worry about. The judgment is serious. It's something that is going to be happening, but it's nothing to cause us stress if we have connected ourselves to Christ. So the question then becomes, how is that possible? That doesn't make any sense for a just and holy God to just pass over sin like that. How can that be? That's a good question. It's an important question. But we find a window into the answer of this question in the Old Testament, actually. The Old Testament prophet Isaiah, he writes about the Messiah. He writes about Jesus when he says in Isaiah chapter 53, starting with verse 5, he says, "He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. By his stripes, we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. See, that's how God deals, how a true and righteous and just God deals with our sin, deals with the judgment. He doesn't just excuse it. He doesn't just pretend like it never happened, because that wouldn't be justice. That wouldn't be fair. But God sees not our sin. He sees our sin placed on our Savior. At the judgment, when we're connected to Christ, we're not the ones that get judged. Jesus is the one that gets judged. God doesn't excuse sin. Instead, our judgment, the penalty for our guilt, has already been placed upon Christ. He has served the sentence of death, but he has been resurrected to eternal life to show that that same promise, that same result, is applied to us when we connect to him. That at the judgment, we don't have to worry, because the judgment has already been passed upon Christ, who is our substitute, who is our Savior, who is our friend, and now will be our judge. The good news about the judgment, the great news, the radical concept, the radical teaching about the judgment, broken down to three parts, is this, is that Jesus himself is the judge. I mean, this is radical. It's not some mean, stern guy looking to fry as many people with lightning bolts as he can. Jesus himself is the judge. The good news, part two, is that Jesus will identify those who belong to him. Jesus knows who is his and who isn't. Jesus knows who follows him, who has looked truly in faith to the cross, who truly believes that he died for them. He identifies those who belong to him and will not make a mistake, will not make us get lost in the crowd. But he identifies those of us that belong to him. And the third part of the good news and the judgment is that for those of us who belong to Jesus, the outcome of the judgment is already settled. It's already done. It's already a done deal if we have connected ourselves to Jesus Christ. Jesus says, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment. It's clear. This radical teaching of Jesus is clear, but have passed from death into life. In fact, there's a wonderful promise that Jesus says in John chapter 10. He says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. This is why Jesus can make the right distinction on the judgment day. Because when we're his sheep, we know his voice. He knows us, and he can make that distinction. And this is a beautiful promise, but it doesn't end there. Verse 28 says, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. No one can destroy your relationship with Jesus. No one can come along and take you out of the hand of the Savior. And this is amazing news. This is why we can have confidence and have faith and have certainty and assurance that the judgment is not to be worried about. This judgment is not to cause us fear or anxiety. Because when we connect to Jesus, when we know his voice, when we follow him, that's all there is to it, because we are in his hand and cannot be snatched out by any other person. There was a woman named Violet. She was about in her late 80s, early 90s, when she was admitted to her hospital's ICU. Her health wasn't going too well, and in fact, her life was slowly draining away, and there was nothing anyone could do about it. But her pastor came to visit, to comfort, to encourage her. When the pastor visited, Violet looked at her pastor and said, "Pastor, thank you for coming, but you know what? I don't need any encouragement because I have already looked at the cross of Christ. Because I believe that Jesus is my Savior. I know his voice and I followed him. And you know what? I believe that on the last day, that on the final judgment day, I have nothing to worry about because I have been in the palm of Jesus' hand for decades. And there's no one that can snatch me out." Violet understood this truth, this radical teaching of Jesus, that the judgment is good news if we are connected to the judge. And so, what is there to be afraid of at the judgment? Nothing. So let the judgment come. Let the righteous judge, Jesus, take his seat on that judging bench. Let him proclaim and declare who belongs to him. Let us know that this is going to happen, but there's nothing to be worried about because you believe in Jesus. See, for those who belong to him, for those who belong to Jesus, the judgment is good news. This morning, there might be those of us here that have been worried about that final judgment because we haven't truly looked to the cross of Christ in faith, because we haven't truly connected ourselves to our Savior. And we know that the judgment's coming, and we have this fear because we know that because we haven't had that faith connection, we know that we're going to be standing alone on that judgment day. But the good news is, none of us have to. That it doesn't matter what you've done or what you think the case might be against you, that when you connect yourself to the Savior of the world, that he will stand with you on that judgment day, that your judge will stand there as your friend on that judgment day, and will let you pass from death into life. So this morning, if that's where you're at, if that's been your experience, and you haven't truly looked to the cross in faith, you haven't really gotten your gaze shifted from your own stuff, from your own life, from your own desires and your own riches and your own world, and you haven't shifted your gaze to Jesus, today is the perfect day to do so. Because today, you can hear those words that Jesus spoke to Zacchaeus, salvation has come to your house. Today, you can have that assurance that on that final judgment, you will not stand alone. Today, look in faith to the cross of Christ. But there might be others here this morning that have looked and been looking in faith to the cross of Jesus. And we feel we've been doing our best to connect to him. But still, when we think about the judgment, we get afraid. We're anxious. We don't know what's going to happen. We don't know what the verdict is going to be. But the good news is, it really isn't about how good of a job we've been doing. It's not about the amount of good deeds that we have done. It's not about we haven't tried hard enough. The good news is, that all we have to do is truly believe that Jesus has already been judged in our place. The good news is that today, if we really truly believe and have our faith in Christ, that we can have that assurance that the judgment is a done deal, that we don't have to keep going and back and forth and wondering if we're saved or if we're not. If we are connected with Christ, if we hear his voice and we follow him and we believe in him and the one who sent him, the judgment is a done deal. The judgment has been settled and there is no need for panic. There is no need for worry. There is no need for stress. Because that judgment day is going to be not a day of pain or a day of fear. It's going to be a day of joy and atonement. Because that day is going to be a day when we will be put back together with our God. This morning, do you want to fear the judgment? This morning, do you want to have the good news of the judgment in your heart and in your life? This morning, if you want that judgment day to be a good day, a day to look forward to, a day that you can meet your Savior and your judge, if you want to look forward to that day being connected to Christ, would you raise your hand? Praise God. Praise God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we are so amazed, really, at the good news of the judgment. Being judged is never fun. No one ever wants to really stand before a judge, whether we're innocent or guilty. But Lord, today we have heard some truly radical things. That because of who you are and what you have done for us, what your Son has done for us, Lord, we can look forward to the judgment, that we can have assurance in that judgment day, that we might not be found guilty, but that we will be found innocent. And that we will be given that life eternal which you have promised to us. Lord, you have seen the hands that have been raised today, that of those of us that want to look to the cross of Christ in faith, those of us that don't want to stand alone on that judgment day, those of us that want to be connected to Jesus, our judge and our Savior, our friend. And so, Lord, I pray that for everyone that has lifted their hands this morning, that we will continue to look at the cross, that we will place our faith in you, that we will hear your voice and follow you every day of our lives. In the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, we pray. Amen.